Having seen SS7 in great detail, let us look at some important criteria for the design of telecommunication systems in this slide. What could be the primary concern? The design for a telephone switch is influenced by the expected traffic intensity during the busy hour. The traffic intensity in turn can be mathematically defined as the calling rate multiplied by the average holding time of a call. The busy hour is that hour during which the traffic intensity is at its highest. Busy hour is quantified as a continuous 60-minute period. How many people attempt to make a call during the busy hour could be the calling rate. Having got a connection, how long they talk could be the holding time. Holding time in PSTNs is normally taken as 3 minutes. Grade of service, what is this? In telephone switch design, as we said just now, busy hour traffic is a key factor used for planning purposes. Next step is to define a performance objective. Example 1. 100 people attempt to make calls during peak busy hour and the switch ensures all 100 people get access. This is called a non-blocking switch with a 0% grade of service. Non-blocking and 0% grade of service. This of course is an ideal switch, but with excessive and wasteful investments. In such switches, during non-peak hours, bulk of the resources or circuits or trunks will be idle and the return on investment obviously will be pathetic. But please note, the customers will be very pleased with the quality of service because everyone who wants to make a call will be allowed service. Customer is happy, the investor is not happy. Example 2. 100 people attempt to make calls and we consciously make provisions only for 95 calls to get through. We deliberately make sure that the remaining 5 people do not get access and receive only busy tones. This is called a blocking switch with a 5% grade of service. Certain percentage of calls are lost because no equipment is available at the instant of the call request. This allows more efficient investment management with acceptable grade of service. Lesser investment on infrastructure and higher return on investment, but please note the customers have to be a little unhappy and they have to tolerate a slightly degraded quality of service. So what is grade of service finally? GOS is a measure of congestion. This is expressed as the probability that a call will be blocked or delayed. GOS is expressed as a probability. GOS of 2% means that 98% of the calls will reach a called instrument if it is free. In other words, 2% means the blocking probability is 2%. Delay criteria, what is this? If the design of the system is based on a fraction of calls getting delayed longer than a specified length of time, then the system is said to be a waiting system or this is engineered on a delay basis. Delay criteria are used in telephone systems for the dimensioning of registers. In waiting system, a GOS objective could be either the percentage of calls which are delayed or the percentage which are delayed more than a certain length of time. The next criteria will be congestion. When there is a congestion, a subscriber cannot obtain a connection to the wanted subscriber immediately. It happens during peak hours in blocking switches. It happens when too many subscribers are concentrated in one area. The examples could be office complexes during busy hour, cricket, football stadiums during a match, traffic jams, a calamity in a particular place like a fire accident or a train accident, and so on and on. In these type of situations, congestion definitely occurs. What are the typical GOS values, grade of service values? GOS for internal calls is 3-5% and for trunk calls 1-3% and for outgoing calls 2% and for incoming calls 2%. The overall GOS of a system is approximately the sum of the component grade of service. As part of our advent of digital communication systems chapter, let us look at the evolution of switching systems. We will begin this chapter tracing the evolution of switching systems. We will address basics of wired communication, the evolution of switching technologies analog and digital. Then look at basics of switching system, in which we'll deal with telephone switching, functions of switching, echo cancellation, and so on. We'll then move to space switching. We'll look at the evolution of manual exchanges, followed by step-by-step closure exchanges, and the crossbar exchanges. These could be typically analog switching types. Then we'll move to digital switching, which is based on electronic switching. We look at an important concept called stored program exchanges. Then we'll trace what is message switching. We'll move on to circuit switching, in which we'll look at space division switch, time division switch, space switch and a time switch, and time and space switch. We'll look at all four combinations that are possible. Then we'll look at packet switching in some detail. Let's move over to evolution of switching systems. Let us now move on to switching systems. What is the evolution of switching systems? Let us look at the historical development. Please note, switching did not happen overnight. By the early 1800s, scientists had developed ways to generate and transmit electricity. 1819, Oyster discovered the relation between magnetism and electricity. 1820, Ampere, Faraday and others continued this work. 1834, Gauss and Weber wired over the roofs of Göttingen to make a telegraph system. Samuel Morse developed the first significant work in telecommunications. 1837, Morse developed code telegraphy. 1844, a 40-mile telegraph line was set up between Baltimore and Washington by Morse. 1845, Morse formed a telegraph company based on his technology. 1849, the first slow telegraph printer link was set up. 1874, Band Dot invented a multiplexer system which enables up to 6 signals from telegraph machines to be transmitted together over the same line, some sort of multiplexing. Elisha Gray and Alexander Bell contributed significant works and filed papers related to telephony. The early stages of the development of telecommunications were due to Graham Bell, Marconi and Shannon. 1876, Bell invented a telephone system. 1897, Marconi patented a wireless telephone system. Teletypewriter service was initiated in 1931. Therefore, look at the evolution. It started in 1819 and it is still going on. The destination still does not appear to be in sight. The process of evolution is on and on and on. In this slide, let's look at some of the basics of a switching system. Some basic telephony terms. What is an analog line? Look at the figure. The communication path between a telephony central office switch and one end user's telephone set, typically based on a physical loop. The subscriber phones are connected to the PSTN invariably through copper wires. This segment is known as local loop. What are the elements of a communication system? Look at this figure. Figure shows the telephony network and services. There can be four classifications: customer premises equipment or end instruments, transmission system, switching system, and lastly the signaling. What is CPE or customer premise equipment? CPE is a term used to identify any piece of equipment used by the customer to interface with the PSTN. It's a generally used term and covers any equipment the customer uses when calling the PSTN. There are many services available on the PSTN and many different varieties of CPE. Some examples can be telephones, modems, EPA BXS and so on. What do we mean by transmission facilities? Look at this figure. Transmission facilities provide the communication paths that carry traffic between nodes of PSTN. Transmission systems provide circuits which carry electrical signals between two destinations. The transmissions can be through guided media, copper cables or fiber optic cables, or unguided media, which can be wireless radio, microwave and infrared. There are two main categories of transmission paths in the PSTN. One is lines, the other one is trunks. Lines are communication paths from the CPE to the switching office. Some examples are copper wire, UTP, unshielded twisted pair, STP, shielded twisted pair, coaxial cables, microwave radios, satellites, fiber optics, and so on. Lines are also called customer loops or local loops, terms derived from original pair of wires that formed a loop between the customer and the switching office. Lines are dedicated to individual customer or subscriber. What do we mean by trunks? These are communication paths between two switching systems, that is between two local exchanges and between local exchanges and primary, secondary group exchanges. Typically, these are communication paths between two exchanges and no customer premise equipment is involved in trunks. What do we mean by switching systems? The switching centers receive the control signals, messages or conversations and forward to the required destination after processing. A switching system has an array of switching elements specifically designed to set up communication paths between two given points. A switching center with its switching network and the control and support equipment is called a central office. In telephone networks, the method employed is circuit switching, and in the data world belonging to computers, the method employed is packet switching. The switching revolution was step-by-step, crossbar system, digital switching system, electronic switching system, and so on. Let's go to signaling. What is signaling? We have seen this already extensively in the previous section. Signaling provides interface between different types of networks and different standards of transmission and different protocols. The introduction of signaling system was a very significant step in improving the PSTN. The Consultative Committee on International Telegraphy and Telephony, CCITT, based in Geneva, recommended 7 formats related to signaling. The first 5 formats related to in-band signaling and the last 2 related to category of common channel signaling. In in-band signaling, voice information and signaling information travel on the common paths, whereas in common channel signaling, they travel on separate paths. We have already seen this in detail. What are the functions of a PSTN network? Let's look at it. Look at this figure. There are broadly 2 functions performed by telecommunication network. Switching. This is a function related to establishing the calls based upon the information provided by the subscriber and releasing the call after usage. This function is carried out by switches or what is popularly known as exchanges. Transmission. This is related to carrying the voice and other signals in either analog form or digital form from one exchange to another. This involves carrying the trunks after multiplexing many of them. Earlier, this was performed by frequency division multiplexing or FDM. And in modern times, this is done by time division multiplexing or TDM. What's a switching office? Switching office, let's look at this figure. This is very often inaccurately called as PSTN, Public Switched Telephone Network. PSTN's central office connect to the subscribers through local loops. Central offices also interconnect with other central offices through trunks and route or switch traffic through the mesh of central offices. Central offices are typically telephone exchanges. Okay, then what is PSTN? A PSTN is a mesh of such central offices, their trunks, their local loops, and all transmission systems that are included in this mesh. This is a PSTN. PSTN is a very large network consisting of several central offices. Fine. What happens during switching? Look at these 2 figures. Let's take a very basic end-to-end telephony system. Please note that it's a basic system we are talking about, and therefore many variants will not be discussed in this. It will have a telephone at the calling subscriber's location and a telephone at the called subscriber's location. The phones will be connected to switches or telephone exchanges or central offices. The exchange will have inbuilt intelligence to handle all activities or all phases of a telephone call mentioned earlier on, in the signaling slides. In a typical call between subscribers, there could be multiple exchanges en route leading to a PSTN. The PSTN switch also houses a switching office, and this will have a control section to analyze what the subscriber wants and direct a network to do the appropriate switching. If subscriber 1 wants to talk to subscriber 8, then the control network will park subscriber 1 in termination A and subscriber 8 in termination B, and then interconnect A and B for this particular call. Once a call is over, this interconnection will be removed and allotted to maybe another pair of subscribers who want connectivity. Switching offices interconnect subscribers at various key locations and route or switch traffic through the complete PSTN. The switching offices are centrally located throughout the PSTN and also are referred to as central offices. There are two essential parts of a switching office. The first one is a switching network. This provides connections between the customer lines, the transmission facilities, and also the switching offices. This is involved in mere connections. The second one is switching control mechanism. This deals with controls. This responds to signals on the switching network portion and directs the switching connections through the switching network. The second part is control. The first part is just connectivity. Both the switching network and the switching control architecture have advanced over the years as the PSTN has evolved. Look at this figure. This example is oversimplified and is meant only to illustrate the basics of switching. Three exchanges located at different areas within a city are shown. Two calls are in progress through distinct switching paths, and they are shown here as animation. This animation is self-explanatory. The exchanges determine the switching paths and allocate dynamically. The connection between various exchanges en route can be through copper wires, special telephonic cables, radios, or fiber optic cables, and these are known as trunks. What are the different types of transmissions? Direction of the transmission: simplex system, semi-duplex system, full duplex system, asymmetric duplex system. They have already been explained. These animations will make you understand them better. Look at this figure. This example is oversimplified and is meant only to illustrate the basics of switching. Three exchanges located at different areas within a city are shown. Two calls are in progress through distinct switching paths, and they are shown here as animation. This animation is self-explanatory. The exchanges determine the switching paths and allocate dynamically. The connection between various exchanges en route can be through copper wires, special telephonic cables, radios, or fiber optic cables, and these are known as trunks. What are the different types of transmissions? Direction of the transmission: simplex system, semi-duplex system, full duplex system, asymmetric duplex system. They have already been explained. These animations will make you understand them better. Let us look at evolution of switching technologies in this slide. Let's look at the figures. Let's define switching. ITUT defines switching as the establishing on demand of an individual connection from a desired inlet to a desired outlet within a set of inlets and outlets for as long as it is required for the transfer of information. Quite formidable, but very simple. What's the historic preview of switching evolution? Initially, 120 years ago, Switching meant an operator interconnecting two subscribers with each other. Present-day switching equipment handles much more. For example, high-quality audio, high-speed data from PCs and LANs, many types of video, interactive cable TV, and so on. One aspect is the switching of information related to the user. The other part is how to make all this happen between end users. Information is required by the network to do all this, which is called signaling information. This also needs to be switched. So signaling needs to be switched and information also needs to be switched. All telephony networks are predominantly circuit switching networks even today. As the applications increased and data also got onto the telephony networks, demand for better utilization of transmission capacity and larger bandwidth emerged, and other techniques such as packet switching have emerged as supplements. Today, we also have other packet switching technologies such as frame relay and two types of cell switching, asynchronous transfer mode ATM and distributed queue dual bus DQDB. What's the technology evolution like? Three distinct phases in the technology evolution. The early switching was done manually by operators using cards with plugs and jacks, talking to users and manually switching the calls. Subsequently, electromechanical switches were developed that were motor driven or electromagnetically operated and that responded to electrical signals or pulses. The step-by-step switching system invented by Almon Strozier in 1892 is still quite popular. The next automatic electromechanical switching system was crossbar switching. The significant inventors were Reynolds in 1915 and Betu Lander and Palmgren in 1919. In 1938, AT&T Laboratories in US introduced crossbar switching system in the field. Then came the electronic switching. Read relays and semiconductor devices are now being used. Electronic switching system, ESS, or electronic automatic exchange, EAX. They are computer controlled using stored program control. Electronic switching offices have two classifications. Analog switching network that switches a call as an analog voice grade signal. Digital switching network that converts a call from analog to digital and switches a call as a digital signal.